We have Dr. Dharmesh Kapoor again with us to speak on renal dysfunction and liver diseases.
Good evening. I'll be confining myself only to renal dysfunction and chronic liver disease and not acute liver failure. So this is a huge problem that all of us face, and in fact, the epidemiological studies have shown that about up to one half of patients who are hospitalized with a label of cirrhosis might have some degree of renal dysfunction. Creatinine is also a very important component of all the liver disease severity scores, and that's probably one of the reasons why, you know, the child pew, they must be turning in their graves because they never gave importance to this particular parameter. It figures in scores like the MELD, the CLIF SOFA, and the APASIS scores, which is for the acute and chronic liver failure severity. It is also one of the most important determinants of short-term prognosis in ICU-bound cirrhotic patients, as well as in the post-liver transplant patient. So if one were to ask this question, what is the most important determinant of survival in a patient who undergoes a transplant? One of the most important determinants is the need for renal replacement therapy in the post-transplant period. So this is the first audience question. The commonest cause of renal dysfunction in a hospitalized cirrhotic patient is pre-renal AKI, acute tubular necrosis-related AKI, HRS or hepatorenal syndrome AKI, or post-obstructive renal dysfunction. Excellent. So this is the famous study from Garcia-Sao, which is all hospitalized patients with chronic liver disease, and you can see that almost two-thirds of them would be having pre-renal and host of reasons because of nausea, vomiting, poor oral intake, they just don't feel like eating, the use of laxatives, so on and so forth. So these are the common causes of pre-renal AKI in these patients. In fact, the intrarenal causes of AKI are also far more common than this particular fanciful diagnosis which all of us are so fond of discussing and which would consume a lot of the time in this talk too, which is hepatorenal syndrome. So actually the intrarenal causes of acute kidney injury are far more common than even type 1 HRS, but because it carries a very high mortality, it takes away most of our attention. So what are the pitfalls of using serum creatinine value? So the pitfalls of using creatinine value as a marker of renal function or dysfunction in cirrhosis are all except. It's dependent on age, gender, muscle mass, interference with elevated serum bilirubin levels, exclusively filtered by the glomeruli and therefore gives us a good idea about the eGFR, and the abnormal value indicating renal dysfunction is not really known in this cohort. So the answer is C. So in patients with chronic liver disease, even though you would want the creatinine, so what is eGFR? So that is the estimated GFR based on the creatinine value. So you would expect that all the creatinine is being filtered through the glomeruli. But in patients with chronic liver disease, a proportion of creatinine that you see in the urine is also secreted through the tubules. And this is the most important thing actually in this question. We really do not know what is an abnormal value of serum creatinine in a patient with cirrhosis. It's just like the LDL. Nobody really knows what is a normal LDL for Homo sapiens. So these are the various formulae that we use all the time for deriving the estimated GFR. So you can see this is the bedside formula, the Cockcroft-Gault formula. All of these formula, they are based on the ethnicity, the serum creatinine values, the age, and the gender of the patient. If you were to add to this the serum urea nitrogen and the urine urea nitrogen excretion, you get the MDRD6. So MDRD6 is supposed to be the formula which is closest to the measured GFR in these patients. So please remember the measured GFR is very taxing. Most of the times we resort only to eGFR, but the MDRD6 formula is the one which is the closest to the measured GFR, and that is what should figure in your day-to-day working of these patients. And if you add to that serum albumin, you get the MDRD7, which is inferior to MDRD6. So if you have to use one formula for eGFR, it should be the MDRD6. What is the truth regarding the use of biomarkers in these patients? So how do you diagnose AKI related to the biomarkers in patients with cirrhosis? So they have replaced serum creatinine value in day-to-day management. They are readily available in most centers. They may be measured in the plasma or in the urine, and they prognosticate renal function but not the patient outcome. So traditionally, we talk about biomarkers as being assayed in the serum, but you have some urinary biomarkers also, and they are extremely important in patients with chronic liver disease. So the maximum experience is with this, which is urinary NGAL. This is a famous study from the Barcelona Clinic group, which has shown that when you talk about the plasma NGAL, there is no discriminant level between the pre-renal AKI, the intrarenal AKI, hepatorenal syndrome, and acute tubular necrosis. Whereas if you were to use the urinary NGAL, it does have a discriminant value. It's very important to know that patients with pre-renal AKI, they would have the lowest values, and those who have got the HRS with the presence of infection or ATN-related AKI, they would have the highest value. But please remember that there is a significant overlap in all of these. So these are not readily available. They still haven't been, they haven't replaced serum creatinine values or cystatin C. In the interest of time, I didn't talk about that. And most importantly, you can assay them even in the urine. It's important to remember that at least two biomarkers have also been associated with the outcome in chronic liver disease patients, and these are the urinary NGAL and interleukin 18. So it's not just the outcome with respect to the renal function, but also the outcome of hospitalized cirrhotic patients. The mortality in cirrhosis patients presenting with renal dysfunction depends on the etiology of AKI and is highest in those with hypovolemia-related AKI, parenchymal renal disease, HRS AKI, and sepsis-related AKI. Right, so this is again the patient from the paper from the same group, which showed that actually the so-called acute tubular necrosis, and please remember that HRS can also transcend into acute tubular necrosis. So these are the patients who've got the worst outcomes. However, this patient, this particular paper showed the outcome in the HRS group to be the poorest. But please remember the inflection point is somewhere over here. So what is the median survival in patients who have got HRS1 without transplant? It's about 7 days. So most of these patients would die within 7 days if they do not get proper attention and especially a transplant. So this is how sick or high acuity patients these are. So you can see that the inflection point is somewhere here. So in the first 30 days, the sepsis related or the ATN AKI and the HRS AKI would almost run hand to hand. So this is the category of patients which has got the highest mortality. So the definition of AKI in this population also is based on the ICU definitions now. And we no longer talk of the earlier definition. So the earlier definitions needed the baseline values of serum creatinine value to be 2.5, which was way high for this patient population, which has hardly got any muscle mass. So now you use the standard AKI criteria. So any elevation of serum creatinine value of even 0.3 is good enough over a period of 48 hours to diagnose this. And then again, now stage 1 is categorized into 1A and 1B. It's very important for those of us who care for these patients in the ICU. 1A is, there is an increase, but the baseline serum creatinine value is still less than 1.5. So 1B is when the value is more than 1.5, and those patients, they behave similar to the stage 2 AKI. It's not just the baseline AKI that is important, but also the trend of AKI in these patients as they spend time in the liver intensive care, which is important to determine the prognosis of these patients. So the diagnosis of HRS again has changed based on the International Club Ascites group. So please remember the earlier definitions in 1996 and 2007. They needed the baseline creatinine value to be 2.5, but now we use the AKI guidelines, and even a marginal increase is also good enough. So please remember that these are all standard, and in the interest of time, I would not go into that, but please remember that you should rule out any nephrotoxic drugs. We should also rule out any parenchymal injury. This is one particular condition with which I have a slight difference of opinion. So it's very difficult. We heard from a speaker earlier in the day that you can have shock even with good blood pressure, and you could have a situation where SBP leads to HRS, and these patients, by the time they present to you, they might be having a hemodynamic compromise. So it's not really the most important thing in this definition, but for all the others, you need to know that you need to stop the diuretics, make sure that they receive the volume challenge, and here we don't volume challenge them with crystalloids, but with IV albumin, and then if still there is no improvement in the renal function, you diagnose the HRS AKI. So the important pathophysiologic thing that is happening in these patients, and all of us are aware that the starting point is a huge splanchnic and systemic vasodilatation, is this. So this is the second hit. Most of the patients with chronic liver disease, they have got a hyperdynamic circulation, but something happens in a proportion of these patients which gives us the second hit, and that is what leads to the HRS pathophysiology. So the favorable response, and how do we treat the patients with HRS? This is with the cocktail of terbilprecin and albumin. So we use about 20 to 40 grams of albumin on a daily basis, and we use terbilprecin as the vasoconstrictor. That is the favored vasoconstrictor. There are studies to show that it's slightly better than noradrenaline in this cohort of patients. So what are the favorable, which is the cohort which responds favorably to this cocktail? So the favorable response to terbilprecin albumin infusion is seen in all except patients who are started early on therapy after the onset of HRS, patients with low baseline serum bilirubin values, patients with acute on chronic liver failure grade 1 vis-a-vis ACLF 2 and 3, and patients with absent SIRS criteria. So this is a slightly tricky question. So the answer is D. And I will talk to you in a moment about this study, which showed that patients who have SIRS, probably they have a good reversal of renal function when they are treated with this cocktail. So when you start patients on terbilprecin, we start them at this dose. If there is no decrease in serum creatinine value of more than 25% by, if there is a decrease, you continue the same dose. If there is some decrease but not to this extent, you increase the dose. You can go to a maximum of 2 milligrams Q4 hourly, which means about 12 milligrams per day, and you stop when the creatinine decreases to less than 1.5. Again, you can have a problem with this. You don't really know what the baseline is. So what I would suggest is that you should be within 0.3 milligrams per deciliter of the baseline creatinine value of these patients. You can use the poor man's choices, which is oral midodrine. You start with 7.5 milligrams per day. You can go up to 25 milligrams. Octreotide, 100 micrograms Q6 hourly. You can go up to 200. And for this, you need a central line. And this is again something which is nothing but terbilprecin is a better analog of this. So this is something that we use very rarely. So this is the reverse trial. So the problem with this trial, even though it was a multicentric study in North America, is that huge number of patients were screened to get only about 200 odd patients. And they described two endpoints. One was a complete HRS reversal, which means that you needed two values of serum creatinine of 1.5 48 hours apart. And then this was just the HRS reversal. Even if the value touched 1.5 once, it was good enough. So this was a negative study. So there was no difference between the standard medical treatment and those who were treated with the terbilprecin albumin cocktail. However, the decrease in serum creatinine values were much higher in the combination arm, and the median liver transplant-free survival was 24 versus 21 days, again not statistically significant. The post-hoc analysis showed that those patients who had got positive SIRS criteria, they tended to do better. So even though this was not statistically significant, but there was a trend to statistical significance in this study. So if you have got a heightened inflammatory response, this is the cohort which is likely to do better with this cocktail. What are the traditional factors failing response? Males do better, lower baseline bilirubin values do better, early onset of treatment is better, so you don't wait for the creatinine to become 2.5. Once you have withdrawn the nephrotoxic drugs and you've given the volume challenge with albumin, if the patient is not getting better, you should start them on the vasoconstrictors. And then again, the non-large volume paracentesis group, because here the pathophysiology is a little different. So those patients who have got inflammatory response syndrome at baseline, they tend to do better with this combination. When do you stop the vasoconstrictors? So if you do not see any decline in creatinine values in the first 72 hours, or if there is no reduction in creatinine values by 50% of baseline after 7 days of the maximum dosage, you should stop. In the earlier studies in the North Americas, the maximum number of days for which vasoconstrictors was used was for 2 weeks. There is a proportion of patients, roughly 40% of patients would have a recurrence of HRS1 the moment you stop the vasoconstrictor therapy, and half of them would again respond to this cocktail once you reinstitute vasoconstrictors. You have to be extremely cognizant about the side effects. For some strange reasons, it starts with the peripheral limbs. You also have to examine the perineum of these patients. So we still do not know why, but scrotal ulcerations are extremely common in these patients, and therefore you have to examine these patients very carefully. GI side effects are almost ubiquitous, and most of the patients would have diarrhea. Hyponatremia is again something that you should think about, which happens in these patients. And then of course we have to factor in the huge amount of albumin that you give these patients, and they can go into volume overload. What about tips? So tips is again something that you might want to offer these patients. Please remember that this is a it's an IR procedure, but the important thing to remember is that you can only give it to people who have got typically low MELD scores. So MELD of 15 to 18 is the category in which you can use TIPS. But many of our patients have got high MELD scores. These patients have got background of hepatic encephalopathy, so they are not suitable for a TIPS insertion. It has been shown that TIPS also works much better for the HRS type 2, which is actually a CKD. So please remember the type 2 HRS is a chronic kidney disease physiology, whereas HRS type 1 is an AKI physiology, and this distinction is extremely important for the transplanting physicians and surgeons. However, if there is of this 41 patients in this study, those who were not candidates for TIPS, they did the worst. So TIPS can be used in a proportion of patients. So please remember the absolute cutoff for serum bilirubin values in these patients is 5 milligrams per deciliter. ALK-HEP constitutes a huge proportion of patients that we see, and many of the times these patients are very cholestatic, and therefore TIPS gets ruled out. When do you use renal replacement therapy? When your patient is not responding to these vasoconstrictors and all the other indications for which you might need renal replacement therapy, like volume overload, hyperkalemia, metabolic acidemia, so on and so forth. So what do you do with these patients who are having HRS, which is not getting better with medical treatment? So you offer them liver transplant. So I told you the median survival of patients with HRS 1 is 7 days, of type 2 HRS is about 6 months. So is there any difference in those who get transplanted with HRS vis-a-vis those who get transplanted without HRS? This is a single center study from South Korea. So you can see that there is only an initial decline. So these patients probably being in the liver intensive care and having high MELD scores, high acuity, tend to do much worse early on in the course, but later on the two graphs, they become parallel. And these authors also showed that the living donor patients, they probably did better than the deceased donor. And I would probably relate it to the timing of the liver transplant more than anything else. So you can offer liver transplant to patients who have got HRS. So the last question, this is a 35-year-old gentleman, and I'm sure this is a problem all of us see in day-to-day practice. A 35-year-old gentleman gets admitted with severe ALK-HEP related ACLF3. The serum creatinine value at baseline was 3.5 milligrams per deciliter, which rose to 4.5 milligrams per dil 3 days later while on the terlipressin albumin cocktail. On account of volume overload, hyperkalemia, and metabolic acidosis, CVVHDF was instituted. The best next step of management would be just to continue RRT till such time the renal function gets better. Consider a TIPS stent insertion, list for liver transplant, or list for a simultaneous liver kidney transplant. So the answer is C. So this is something to remember, that when patients have been on renal support for a short period of time, which is in various guidance documents, either 4 weeks or 6 weeks max, these patients can be offered just one organ transplant. So please remember, getting two organs into a sick patient is extremely difficult. In the Western world, you also have to answer questions regarding stewardship of two organs, because the renal waiting list is far, far greater than the liver waiting list. So you are using two organs in someone who's extremely sick, and alcoholic liver disease constitutes a huge chunk of these patients in this part of the world as well as in the Western world. So stewardship for two organs is extremely difficult. If they have been on RRT for less than 6 weeks, you should be considering transplant for them. And that brings me to the summary slide. So please remember, look for the reversible factors. If you have to also factor in the patient phenotype, etiology, comorbidity. In the interest of time, I didn't speak about this. So if you've got 100 patients of cirrhosis presenting to you with renal dysfunction, 70 of them would have AKI. About 18% would also have acute on chronic kidney disease. So in this part of the world, chronic kidney disease is extremely common and underreported, and therefore the treatment modalities would be different. So if you have someone who has responded to the medical therapy but HRS recurs, these are the ones whom you should fast track for liver transplant. And if you have found that this has failed and RRT is needed, you should go in for an early liver transplant, because a standalone single organ is good enough for these patients. As regards those patients who've got the type 2 HRS or CKD, you need to choose your own serum creatinine values. So please remember that need to follow these patients for some length of time before jumping into transplant. You have to use some other tests which we oftentimes miss in our day-to-day practice, including the need for renal biopsy at times, which most of us are guilty of not doing. So please look at the other comorbs, the diabetes, the hypertension, the renal dopplers, the RIS of arcuate artery, so on and so forth. These are simple tests which your sonologist can help you with, and that will help you decide what is the baseline renal function in a given patient. I thank you for your attention, and I'll be very happy to take any questions.
I request Dr. Ninad Deshmukh to felicitate Dr. Dharmesh Kapoor, please.